When we look into the history of the Mission Institutes of Style, we begin first with the founder, Saint Arno Jansen. In a second stage, attention turns to the two co-foundresses of the missionary sisters, servants of the Holy Spirit, Blessed Maria Helena Stollenberg and Blessed Josepha Hendrina Steinmanns. In the history of the foundation of the Servants of the Holy Spirit since 1891 on, we have to include Adolfine Tönnies, later Mother Mary Michael, co-foundress of the Third Congregation of Style, the Sister Servants of the Holy Spirit of Perpetual Adoration. The Congregation of the Sister Servants of the Holy Spirit of Perpetual Adoration came into being thanks to the founder, Saint Arno Jansen. But it is not conceivable without Mother Mary Michael, whose example and purposeful striving gave the congregation its present form and orientation. Mother Mary Michael developed the tiny, delicate, and hidden beginnings of her congregation with patience and perseverance from 1896 on, helping it to grow and thrive and gain standing. The same applies to Mother Mary Michael as to Arno Jansen. It is mainly her work that is seen and described. But to bring that to life and give it a firm basis, that was their God-given calling. Founder and co-foundress disappear beneath and behind the work that they formed with their own spiritual personality and stature. Adolfine was born on January 7, 1862 in Horst, Hampshire, Westphalia, Germany. In the baptismal register, which was at the same time the register of births, Adolfine was entered with the names Adolfina Bernardina Wilhelmina. She herself, however, always wrote her name as Adolfine. In the family, she was called Finchen. The father's photo shows a fine, distinguished-looking and self-assured man in his best years. He was a true Westphalian, dutiful and responsible, rather taciturn. Genuine Westphalians do not speak a lot, but you can trust them. Their word is sure. Adolfine's mother was known for her charity and her love and concern for the poor and the sick, and that alongside taking care of her large family and business household. She showed great trust in God, a trust that was not shaken by the harshest misfortunes. The family was molded in a true Christian spirit. They did not speak much about it. They lived their faith in a practical manner in daily life, in honesty and integrity. Finchen grew up with the natural, deeply believing piety of her family. She was a healthy child, quieter by nature than her brothers and sisters, but not low-spirited. She was interested in everything from which she could possibly learn something. A strong trait of piety showed in Adolfine early on, and that corresponded to her rather quiet nature. Slowly but surely, she developed an ever greater openness to God. That is why her first communion day on April 21, 1875 was such a special day for her. Fincian was 13 years old. Alongside her regular schooling, her parents provided for private tuition in various subjects from the parish priest and other teachers in the town. Probably during that time too, she began learning to play the piano. Adolfine was well prepared for the entrance examination for the Teachers Training College in Münster. The course of studies at the college took 2 years. In summer 1881, she left the college with an excellent certificate. At the end of the course, the candidate teacher Adolfine Tönnies was declared provisionally qualified to carry out the teaching profession in an elementary school. Thus well qualified, she was able to take her first steps in her professional life. For 10 years, she taught in the one-room mission school in Rendsburg, Schleswig-Holstein. Her professional work was the joy of her life. The parish priest, Father Stockhoff, was always full of praise and constantly said, "We have a very good teacher." Joanna Perschke, a colleague and friend, said of Adolfine, "What was so special about her was her great, intense, yet unostentatious piety. She practically lived under the same roof as the Divine Savior, and so daily Mass and frequent visits to the Blessed Sacrament were a natural part of her life. Through her piety, she was a shining example for the entire parish." Her deep tendency towards piety unfolded further in Rendsburg. She could go unseen from her residence into the church. She treasured being literally under the same roof with the Lord in the Eucharist. Holy Mass and frequent visits to the Blessed Sacrament were self-evident for her. On Sundays and Mondays, she goes to Holy Communion regularly. Mondays in honor of the Holy Spirit, whose veneration lies deep in her heart. She concluded her day's work with evening prayer and long adoration in the church. We could say that she was almost leading a religious life. And in the silence of that hour, time and again she heard the call of the Lord, "Follow me." Adolfine's vocation to religious life did not just fall from heaven, but has its own history, developing slowly. During Pentecost week in 1889, she attended a retreat for the teachers of the Northern Mission held in the Ursuline Convent in Eutin from June 10 to 14. Here, for the first time, she spoke about her inner longing and asked for advice. She saw clearly that God was calling her to the religious life, but to where? She remembered her priest uncle, Father Hermann Wegener in Stein. On the feast of the presentation of the Lord in 1890, she wrote to him about her wish. His reply was almost like a liberation for her. He wrote, "I have prayed and had prayers said in this important decision. Now I say to you with great certainty, your vocation to religious life is genuine." After Father Wegener's summons, "Come to Steyr," she wrote to Arnold Jansen on August 24, 1890, requesting to be accepted. Only 4 days later, on August 28, 1890, Arnold Jansen wrote to welcome and admit her to the congregation. Since 1876, the Augustinian sisters from Essen had run a boarding school in the convent Notre Dame. They sold that convent to the mission house in August 1890. That is where Adolfine arrived in Steyr on May 1, 1891, as 18th candidate of the young community of the future congregation of the Servants of the Holy Spirit. Hendrina Steinmann's later sister Josepha was still the community leader until the summer and introduced the newcomers into religious life. She would have greeted and welcomed Adolfine, shown her the way for the first time, and introduced her to the other postulants. On the feast of the Nativity of Mary 1891, 16th anniversary of the foundation of the mission house, when Adolfine had been installed for just 4 months, Arno Jansen arrived at the sisters' convent with a long-awaited announcement that the postulants would soon receive the religious habit. On January 17, 1892, the first investiture took place. 16 postulants were accepted, among them Adolfine Tönnies, who was given the religious name Sister Michael. Thus she was invested with the blue habit of the Servants of the Holy Spirit. She was to wear that habit for almost 5 years. Two of the first 12 sisters were teachers and had already practiced their profession, Sister Michael and Sister Gabriel. We find our Sister Michael Adolfine Tönnies, therefore, from 1894 on, back in her old beloved profession as teacher for her fellow sisters. The teaching was not Sister Michael's only activity. She was also the organist and directed the liturgical singing. She was responsible, however, in taking charge of the newcomers. Still a novice herself, she was now the first postulant directress. On March 12, 1894, the first profession of vows was celebrated. 12 sisters were admitted. The last, dating from entrance into the community, was Sister Michael. After Arno Jansen had given all his attention for the past 7 years to the foundation and development of the Congregation of the Missionary Sisters, which was now blossoming fully, he turned to the completion of this work with the establishment of the Institute of the Cloistered Sisters. The Feast of the Immaculate Conception 1896 was chosen as the foundation date. On that day, Sister Mary Michael, as she was called from then on, and five other sisters were invested with a pink habit, white scapular and veil of the cloistered sisters of Perpetual Adoration, and began their novitiate. The pink habit which they wear as a symbol of their consecration to the Holy Spirit should remind the sisters of His love. The white scapular and veil of the angelic purity which should always adorn their hearts. The tasks of the sisters were prayer and manual work while living a complete and permanent enclosure. The center of their prayer was Eucharistic adoration and the recitation of the Divine Office. Due to the devotion to the Holy Spirit, Arnold Jansen ruled that the sisters were to pray the Office of Pentecost every day. Later on, it was replaced by the complete Roman Breviary. The missionary character of the foundation was expressed in the obligation of intercessory prayer, which he wished to be cultivated by them in every way, to pray for the great intentions of the Church and the world, and for the priesthood. In December 1897, Sister Mary Michael was appointed superior of the small community. What she, as superior, had to cultivate in the sisters under her, she first had to practice under the earnest direction of the founder himself. What she was to offer them as their mother had been deeply implanted by God in her heart, the gift of true sacrificial motherliness. The young community developed steadily. On November 1, 1901, they were permitted to begin Perpetual Adoration before the Blessed Sacrament in the exposed ciborium, to the great joy of the sisters. On its eve, the sisters took special care in adorning the high altar of their very first chapel for this solemn occasion. Meanwhile, the missionary sisters' branch had grown so rapidly that the former convent of the Augustinian nuns, which had been significantly enlarged by the repeated addition of new wings, had become too small. On October 13, 1901, the founder surprised the sisters with the news that a new large convent was to be built for them in the Style Hills. The foundation stone was laid at Pentecost 1902. The building was inaugurated in October 1904, and the cloistered sisters were able to move into their designated south wing on the Eve of All Saints. August 15, 1907 was a day of great grace for Mother Mary Michael. Together with other two cloistered sisters and with eight missionary sisters, she made her final profession. They were the first finally professed sisters of the young cloistered congregation. The Most Reverend Founder presided over the celebration himself. On January 15, 1909, the faithful servant of God, Arnold Jensen, breathed his last. It was a very edifying death. He passed away like a favored son of God. His final word was, Jesus. The sisters had lost their founder and faithful spiritual father in this life, but in him they had gained a powerful intercessor in heaven. On November 5, 1909, Father Nicholas Bloom was elected Superior General of the Society of the Divine Word. 5 weeks later, the sisters too had elected their superiors, whereby Mother Mary Michael was confirmed once again as superior of the Adoration sisters. When the founder died, there were around 40 cloistered sisters, including the aspirants. There was hardly room for more than that, because they only resided in one wing of the convent of the missionary sisters. The latter had also increased so greatly that they urgently needed that wing themselves. Mother Mary Michael regarded it as one of her first and most important tasks to provide her religious community with its own home. She went about it prudently and energetically. On December 9, 1912, Father Superior General Bloom laid the foundation stone of the new convent of the Holy Spirit, a stone taken from the catacombs of Saint Agnes in Rome. Father Bruno Michel from the Mission House St. Michael directed the construction as foreman, and the building operations were carried out by the brothers, all skilled artisans in their various trades. On August 26, 1914, the house was inaugurated and the sisters moved into their new convent. Visitors to the Convent of Perpetual Adoration in style are greeted by a large stone-carved medallion of the Holy Spirit encircled with the inscription, Under the shadow of your wings we dwell. This inscription is symbolic of the loving veneration offered to the Spirit of Love by his cloistered servants. Both medallion and circumscription tell of the strong woman under whose supervision this sanctuary, convent, and chapel were built in honor of the Holy Spirit. As the motto for her congregation, she chose the church's invocation, Emitte Spiritum Tuum, send forth your spirit, and she admonished the sisters frequently to pray it. Mother Mary Michael had set her goal even farther, however. With great satisfaction, she noted how very differently adoration before the exposed Blessed Sacrament stimulated the sisters and powerfully promoted their zeal in prayer. Also in this matter, she strove for a complete solution and did not give up until she attained her goal. On November 6, 1915, the diocesan bishop of Roermond, Monsignor Schreinen, gave the sisters permission for perpetual exposition of the Blessed Sacrament by day and by night without restriction for all future time. Thus, since November 8, 1915, our Savior in His sacrament of love has been enthroned high above the altar of the Adoration Church in Steyl and in all the daughter foundations of the Adoration Sisters. Even if Mother Mary Michael had accomplished nothing more than this, the continual development of perpetual adoration in her congregation to this extent signifies a work of blessing of enduring value. In 1914, after Mother Mary Michael had happily brought the Mother House to completion, she immediately turned to the question of the rule. The bishop agreed that the Adoration Sisters should become an autonomous congregation. With regard to the name, he decreed that a short addition should be made to the former name, and the sisters were to be called Sister Servants of the Holy Spirit of Perpetual Adoration. On July 10, 1917, the sisters received a document of approbation which was dated July 7. On February 27, 1933, 1 year before her death, Mother Mary Michael was still able to add the keystone in the development of the rule when she attained the definitive approbation of the congregation and of the Holy Rule from the Apostolic See. The cloistered branch now became an independent congregation with Mother Mary Michael as its first Superior General. The Chronicle states, at Pentecost 1919, our emblem was approved by Father Superior General Nicholas Bloom. It consists of a monstrance in the form of a cross standing on the globe with a Holy Spirit dove symbol above it. This symbol signifies the special devotion to the Holy Spirit cultivated in our congregation. The monstrance signifies the perpetual adoration and the globe our worldwide mission. When he founded the branch of Adoration Sisters, Arno Jansen had prescribed that the entire office of Pentecost octave from the Roman Breviary was to be prayed each week as a continual repeated choral prayer. This daily office of the Holy Spirit had a special justification for the servants of the Holy Spirit, and the sisters loved to pray it. It had more than a few disadvantages, however, in that it did not go well with the church liturgy of the day, especially on some feast days and holy seasons, and was sometimes even disturbing. The real solution could only be the correct alignment with the liturgy of the church. Since 1922, the sisters pray the liturgical divine office according to the Roman Breviary and the proper of the Society of the Divine Word. On October 14, 1929, the first general chapter of the Cloistered Sisters was solemnly opened, and it convened until February 27, 1930. Mother Mary Michael was unanimously re-elected as Superior General. At this chapter, the constitutions were to receive their definitive form so that they could be submitted to the Holy See for approbation. At the turn of the year 1933-1934, it was slightly noticeable to the sisters that in her response to their good wishes, she spoke so impressively of the very blessed new year, meaningfully adding the words of the Apostle, "While we live for the Lord, and when we die for the Lord. Whether we live or die, we are the Lord's." Did she perhaps has a premonition of death? Soon it became apparent that she felt unwell. When the doctor was called on January 25, he declared her case serious and critical. A serious liver condition was diagnosed. The patient took the diagnosis of the doctor with equanimity. On Sunday, February 25, 1934, just as the reading of the Gospel of the Transfiguration ended, she gave her life back to her Creator with the last audible words, "Jesus, Mary." Mother Mary Michael lives on in her congregation. Although over time many necessary changes had to be made, the original and fundamental spirit of Father Arnold Jansen and Mother Mary Michael has been carefully and faithfully preserved. When she lit the sanctuary lamp in the first humble chapel of her congregation, she never dreamed that one day other lamps would be burning in chapels of her congregation in Europe. Asia, Africa, North America, and South America. We quote Mother Mary Michael, "Perpetual adoration, how beautiful it is! The Blessed Sacrament is indeed the most beautiful and most sublime gift that our small earth and the whole world calls its own." For a servant of the Holy Spirit, every day should be a new Pentecost. Every breath, come Holy Spirit. Every deed, send forth your Spirit. Every heartbeat, Lord Jesus, send us from the Father the Holy Spirit. From Mother Mary Michael. From our 1935 directory, your whole religious life should be unceasing adoration through a life of purity and immolation, of love and total surrender to God, in intimate union with the Eucharistic life of Jesus. Live quietly with God. Work gladly for God. View things from God's viewpoint. Talk things over with God. Glow with zeal for the glory of God. Find your joy in God. Rest deep in the heart of God. Congregatio Servarum Spiritus Sancti de Adoratione Perpetua, SSpSAP, Congregation of the Sister Servants of the Holy Spirit of Perpetual Adoration.